Welcome back, everyone. In today's episode, I'm going to walk you through defining metallic and reflective areas on your objects using your texture maps. In physically based rendering, such as the Principled BRDF shader model we're using, there are several ways to define reflective surfaces, including metallic maps, specularity maps, and roughness maps. Metallic maps are probably the simplest types of maps to create, because you just need to define which areas on your map are metallic and which parts are not, using a black and white map. The reflective colour of the metal is determined by the colour in our base colour map. This is far simpler than creating a specular map, which requires you to define the reflective colour of each part. We can then define how smooth or rough the metal is with a roughness map, which allows you to simulate any microscopic surface irregularities. The more irregularities a surface has, the less pure, reflective or mirror-like it will be. Roughness can also add the most physical variation to our object, even the non-metallic parts, to indicate the age and condition of surfaces. As you can see in this image, a value of 0 indicates a smooth surface, and a value of 1 indicates a rough surface, and values in between indicate transitional smoothness and roughness. Creating our metallic map is going to be pretty quick and simple, especially if you have the selection groups set up from episode 2, because through the selection groups we were able to identify our metal parts from our non-metal. If you didn't set up selection groups, there is a project in the MARI course files with the selection group set up for you. In order to achieve the metallic effect you see in the lower right of this image, you need a metallicity value of 1, which corresponds to fully white, and to achieve a non-metallic appearance like you see in the top left, you need a metallicity value of 0, which corresponds to fully black. So, we need to create another new channel and plug it into the metallic input of our principled BRDF shader. Open the channels palette and click the Add Channel button. Since we're creating a metallic channel, let's call this channel metallic. This really doesn't need to be as big as 2048 by 2048, since we're not painting detail onto this map. All we're doing is painting which area should be black and which should be white. So let's make this map 1024 by 1024. Colour depth can be 8-bit, the lowest, since we're only using black and white colours. Make the colour option black as the base colour, because the majority of our objects is non-metallic, so this saves us a bit of time. As we discussed in the bump map episode, all non-colour data maps need to have scalar enabled to ensure MARI reads in the raw value of the pixel, rather than read it and manage it as colour data. So make sure scalar data is enabled for our metallic channel. Then click OK. Once our metallic channel is created, hook it up to our shader by opening the shaders palette, selecting principled BRDF in the shader panel, and next to the metallic input, click the button and select our new metallic channel. The metallic input will activate and show green on the switch. Nothing will appear to change in our viewport though, because we haven't told the shader that anything on our object is metal yet. So let's go ahead and do that. Open the selection groups palette, and holding shift, click the metal parts and metallic lens groups, so we have all of our metal faces selected. By the way, if you'd like to see what selections you have active in the viewport, right-click the canvas and select display properties, and change the fill render and outline render to always under the selection section. I have mine turned off, which is why they haven't been appearing. In the painting palette, we want to make sure Project On is set to Selected Only, so we only paint on the selected metal parts. Head over to the Ortho UV tab. We're going to paint a flat white on the flat UVs with the paint tool, and it's easy to do something like this on a flat surface, like the UVs. Activate the paint tool with the P key and select white from the colour picker. Turn on current paint target with the I key so you can see what you're painting into a little bit easier. Then just lay your paint down. It should only paint white onto the metal parts. Let's head back to the perspective viewport and turn back on the principled BRDF shader with the I key. It may appear that not much has changed. That's because we now need to define the amount of reflectiveness the metal parts have, using a roughness channel. The shader knows where our metal parts are, and that it should use the base colour of those parts as the reflective colour, but now it needs to know how smooth those surfaces are, and how light should be scattered off them. Let's go to our channels palette and add another new channel. Call this our roughness channel and set the size or channel resolution to 2048 by 2048 since we may require some painted detail on this map, so we need a bit more resolution. Some areas of our object may be glossier than others, especially on parts of the metal where it's worn, so we want flexibility to add detail to our roughness texture where required. It doesn't really matter what we set the colour of our channel to, since we're going in and painting the details of our roughness anyway. Make sure you enable scalar data in the colour space section. Click OK. Once the roughness channel is added, input this channel into our principled BRDF shader in the roughness input, so we can view the roughness in the viewport. Whatever your base colour was set to defines the current roughness of our object. If you had a colour closer to white, then the roughness will appear less reflective and more diffuse. If you had a colour close to black, then the roughness will appear highly glossy and reflective. Remember that roughness isn't just used for shiny or metallic surfaces. It can be used for matte surfaces too, to add breakup in the way light scatters off it. I'm going to give you the basics of creating your roughness maps, and then you can go ahead and use those techniques for the rest of the surfaces on our objects, since you should spend quite a bit of time working on roughness in order to achieve a realistic look, just like our base colour map. The more variation your roughness maps have, the more realistic your objects will appear. Let's identify areas we know for sure are either highly smooth or highly rough. I'm going to delete this base colour layer in our roughness channel first because it's making everything way too shiny for me. Whatever the colour input when we created the roughness channel was set to, defines the current roughness of our object. Note that without a layer in the channel is now outputting transparency, which feeds into the shader, which then composites the transparency over the default roughness value in our shader. This is a value of 1 in our principled BRDF shader, which is why the camera no longer appears shiny. The camera lens, being made out of glass, has no roughness at all, really. So let's paint this black in the roughness channel. Make sure your roughness channel is selected and create a new layer. Open the selection groups palette so we can pick our lens faces. Click the glass lens group to select it. Ensure selected only is active in the project on option in the painting palette. And then with the paint tool, pick black from the color picker and paint directly onto the lens face. Immediately we can see how glossy this becomes. If we wanted to go ahead and create the illusion of smudges on this glass, using the roughness channel is great because we can define where the light doesn't reflect off the smudged areas. As an example, let's create a new layer in the roughness channel. And in the shelf palette, select the fingerprint brush from the organic brushes tab. Select a colour that's closer to white. And click and drag over the lens surface to paint down a fingerprint. If you rotate the camera around our lens, you can see how the light diffuses around the fingerprint to create the illusion of smudges. You can create new layers for each kind of breakup you want to add to your surfaces, so you have as much control as possible over them in case you want to adjust them later. For our metals, select all the metal parts from the selection group palette. Since we've already defined these parts as metal in the metallic channel, all we need to do is define the surface breakup. I've taken a look at some animated references of this camera, and the metal here is actually quite brushed and rough as opposed to perfectly mirror-like. For our metals, select the metallic lens and the metal parts groups from the selection group palette. Remember to multi-select with the shift key. In our roughness channel layer palette, add a new constant layer and set it to around 0.45, so we're creating a roughness that's somewhere in the middle of smooth and rough. Also change the components to RGB, since we don't want the value to affect the alpha component. This is going to be our base value for the metallic roughness. Then we're going to add a lighter value on top to create some roughness and breakup on this metal surface. Add another constant layer and set the colour to 0.5. In order to create the breakup between these two values, we'll group the two layers together by selecting both and clicking the Group Layers button, and then provide a name for the group, something like Metal Breakup. Then right-click the group layer and select Layer Mask, Add Mask from Selection, and this is going to mask off the whole group to our selection. We'll create a mask stack on the top constant layer so we can define where the bottom value is shown and where the top value is shown. So select the layer and click Add Mask Stack as we want to add some procedurals to this mask. We're going to add a cloud procedural layer as it's a quick way to create some decent looking breakup between the two constant layers we just created. Open the mask stack and click Add Procedural Layer, Procedural, Fractal, Cloud. Make color A value 95 and color B value 40. This is affecting the values of the mask itself, so the values we've chosen here mean the bottom constant we created earlier only shows through slightly, since we are picking colours closer to white, which in a mask means the top layer is retained. To create the brush metal effect, we can change the roughness to something much higher to create the look of these microscopic metal surface abrasions. You have to be aware that if you set the cloud size too small, the channel resolution we currently have won't be able to handle it and the noise will be lost upon export. A value of around 0.5, which is the default, should be fine though. If you're finding that your metal appears too dark, you can go back into the original base colour channel and lift the colour values of your metal parts layers, since they're informing the metal reflectiveness of the metallic channel. Next, let's create a matte finish for the Lubitel sticker. So for this one, we're going to copy the Lubitel sticker layer over from the base colour channel again, so we don't need to repaint it. Select the Lubitel sticker and the torn layer underneath with the Shift key. Right click and select Copy. Then in our Roughness channel, right click one of the layers in the layer palette and select Paste. I don't want them in the metal breakup group, so I'm moving them out. We need to add a levels adjustment to our Lubitel sticker layer and make the entire layer something closer to white, so it has very little reflectivity and creates more of a matte finish. Click the adjustment stack icon, or if there isn't one, right click the layer, select adjustment stack, add adjustment stack, levels. Activate current paint target in the viewport with the I key so we can see what we're doing. And then in our adjustment stack, push the black output level slider of the levels layer all the way to 1.0, so only white appears in the image. And then bring both the black and white output levels down slightly, so it's not 100% white, since even matte surfaces have a small level of light reflection. You can use the techniques from this video to add roughness to the camera's body and parts. Remember that nothing is truly 100% rough, and nothing aside from perfectly smooth mirrors or glass like the lens we just worked on is 100% smooth. Almost everything in reality has some level of breakup. Make sure to study your references and use the painting and masking techniques we've shown here to get as close as you can to the original surface. I hope you enjoyed this episode, and I'll see you in the next one.